We don't have
an updated
data. So this is what we have. I'm not so sure if this is nowadays, but this is what we have. So with a business as usual approach, we will have double of cars. So today, as I said, we had 5.5 in Mexico City, and we will have 11. And the pollutants will also be double. And people will be spending from 1 hour to almost 2 hours traveling just because of traffic congestion with a business as usual approach. So, but what is a business as usual approach? What I'm meaning is that, yes, as I said, over 80% of roads are dedicated to cars, but only 20. What it is explained here is that budget allocated to mobility, 80% is dedicated to cars, even though only 20% of population travel by car. So in contrast, you are dedicating resources, less than 20%, to 80% of the population who travel by public transportation. So you are not allocating the public resources in an efficient, equitable way. So what we have here is income distribution. So here are the poorest people, the third. I must explain it. This is national. This is not from the metropolitan area. Okay, the first one are the poorest, the 10% poorest people in Mexico, the country, and these are the richest. As we can see, the percent are the number of cars that they share, they own. So what we can say see here is that the richest people own the car, mostly. So when the government is allocating resources to the richest people, we have a regressive policy. And in contrast, people traveling from the state of Mexico to Mexico City in 2014, 50% of these people spend over $3 a day, but minimum wage is 5%. So these people are allocating over 50% of their income in public transportation. I mean, this is regressive. Okay. What are the causes? Why people want to travel by car? So.
She has good reasons.
Over 40% of people traveling by car from the state of Mexico to Mexico City in 2014 revealed that they chose travel because of safety. I'm going to show you something. Here we have that also in 2014, Mexico City was the second most dangerous city for women in public transportation. Why? Because there is sexual harassment. According to the World Bank, 2 out of 3 women traveling in Mexico City had sexual harassment. So, we also have, I'm a cyclist, so it is dangerous being a cyclist as well. I don't have data of this. I need to come back. So, and the second most important reason for traveling by car is time. So why time? I mean, this is not representative. This was my travel today. I'm staying in this place, Torres and Ixquat. It's a gated community, by the way. I don't live there. I'm just staying over the week. I don't live there, but...
I'm just living there.
I don't live there.
So I don't live here. I'm just staying over this week, and I had to decide how to commute here. So I went to Google, I searched, and I saw that if I took the public transportation, it would take me over 1 hour to get here, to take the Monterrey. It is right here. So then I saw that if I took a taxi, it would take me less than 30 minutes. I mean, less than half the time.
How many was the distance?
Almost 20 kilometers, or it is over here, 21 kilometers. So what I did is I took a taxi. But I must say, I spent 100 pesos here, but minimum wage is about 80 pesos. So my one way trip is more than minimum wage a day. So most of people cannot afford this. It's very expensive. And there's a further reason. If also I took a look on public transportation, it was overcrowded. I was in the station and I couldn't get in. It was full, I mean it was overcrowded. And it was a line of people staying, waiting for the bus. So, I need to come back. The third reason for driving by car is convenience. 21% of people travel by car because of convenience. So, I mean, these are common pictures in Mexico City. This is minibus. Minibuses, that's what we say. Crowded, overcrowded. And this is Patrick Lane station, a metro station. This is Mixcoac. So this is in right outside the station. So it is full of street vendors. You ask me why I hate street vendors. Well, I don't hate them. I just think they are not so nice to be there. So, as we said, about 80% of people travel by public transportation. And 5 out of 10 people travel by minibuses, I mean low capacity transport. Five out of 10 people traveling use minibuses. But why people use these public transportation when it is very bad, or sometimes? And people say that people traveling from the state of Mexico to Mexico City reveal that they choose public transportation because it was cheaper and because it was the only option. So 50% said that. And we have a further problem, is that in this travel from the state of Mexico to Mexico City, 40% of people had to use 4 or more modes, transport modes. So, I mean, it is fragmented. Transportation is fragmented. So, and what are the causes of all this? Yesterday, we were talking about some institutional issues in Guadalajara. Do you remember? And some of the reasons Bern said was short-term horizon of the mayors. And I should hear a little bit. And I put something different. I put that it was lack of skilled decision makers. Maybe it might be a little bit tough, but what I'm saying here is that in Mexico City, some of the people who are responsible for decision making, for instance, I mean, some of the main ministries, they are political positions. They are not competitive, skilled, awarded. So I'm worried about that. I mean, I'm not saying that it is, you know, it is in every place, but sometimes in Mexico that happens. So
can I ask a question? I've been wondering this. So every position we've talked about in the last 3 days when we talked about governance has been a politically appointed position. So are there any technocratic positions that are like civil service positions where there are decision makers?
Yes, some kind. I don't think that would happen in transport, but I think in energy, in telecommunications, and in COFESE, this is the competition authority. The competition authority, I think they have a competitive process. Mm-hmm. I think they
but
have.
Most of them are politically appointed. Decisions.
Most of them are politically appointed.
It's not different from the U.S.
Yeah.
I mean, and this is not an untypical kind of thing. I don't think this is a Mexican problem. I mean, Trump or anybody comes in the U.S., he gets the 500 top positions. He refills these positions. Okay. The Democrats did the same thing, and so yes, you try to get competent people, but it's still partisan people.
Yes, or sometimes it is some kind of mix. You have a competitive process, you get the three person, I mean the most skilled, and then the president comes and says, okay, from these three people, I will choose this one.
Yeah.
So it is how it works here. So we also have lack of accountability, lack of transparency and data. We already discussed that. And a very important thing, it is the political opposition, I mean different parties in Mexico City and the state of Mexico, so they don't talk to each other, so they have different parties. So all this institutional setup has an effect on the cooperation, both vertical, I mean, or I mean it's with the national level, with the local level, also have a jurisdictional problem between different states. We also have a problem with transport and housing and transport. They do not cooperate very much, or somehow it is disconnected. And one very important thing is the lack of participatory mechanisms. Nowadays, it has been improved. I must say, it has improved. But not so, I mean, there are still many things to do in this sector, in this topic. So, this system has prioritized motorized mobility. But there are other stakeholders that press into this direction. We have some business pressure, I mean car industries.
Sure.
We also have drivers pressure. I mean, drivers don't want to leave the car. So all this impacts on the decision-making process, on the planning, and we already discussed that, I think, it was the regulatory part. I mean, regulation is tangled, it is fragmented. We have several authorities. I must say, I've been studying energy and telecommunications. They are not perfect, but at least they are. The structure is clearer.
Yeah.
Here, I have no idea. I must say, I have no idea how it works. I still don't know how it works in this part.
You're not the only one. We have the same in the movie.
We have the same problem, yeah. And transport is more fragmented than electricity or telecom or post, or because there are more modes of transport, you know, they have their own. I mean, that's what I'm doing in Florence. I do rail. I mean, on Monday we did road workshop, and the road people have never talked to the train people, you know, and they don't talk to the bus people, and they don't talk to the airport people, and so it's much more, transport is much more friend. They have their own authorities, their own things. So, yeah.
Yeah,
but this is a useful thing to even map who are the relevant actors?
We are not the only one. So, I think I already explained all this part on the previous slides. So, all this lack of a regulatory body and structure has effects on traffic congestion. One more thing, and this is very important. I was not going to talk about this topic, but I think it's very important. And it is externalities. I mean, I'm an economist, so I needed to talk about externalities. It's part of it.
I'm sorry. You have three frameworks or just one? I can see here three parts.
Three parts. They are all related.
Okay, but I don't know. I cannot see. Just to know,
sorry,
the first one is the institutional
design. The first
design.
One is institutional
and
design.
In the middle?
This impacts the metropolitan governance system,
okay.
Which in turn impacts the planning and also affects the financial situation. How do you allocate resources?
Okay.
And these metropolitan governance systems, and with some stakeholders, with this kind of stakeholders, have prioritized motorized mobility. I'm not so sure if I put it in the right way, but this is how I understand it. So, and we have this regulation. Maybe I should have some further arrow in this direction, from metropolitan governance to regulation.
But this left part is what?
It's
the operational.
No, I don't think so.
Because for me it's clear that the right part is the institutional design.
Okay, then it will be the operational. We have safety, fragmented public transportation, poor convenience, accessibility, affordability. We have a dependency on private motorized travel. I mean, maybe it was not that clear.
You have several things in there.
That's okay, because that's the way Brenda's understanding the problem, and then Brenda's trying to understand how it works.
No, it's already great.
So we have here we have the infrastructure and design of mobility. So we have urban sprawl. We have and what for me was very important externalities. So everybody is aware what. An externality is? Do you know?
Yeah.
Yes? Okay, then I'll stop.
But that's part of the action learning. We can then improve that kind of thing.
Exactly. That's the purpose of the
whole thing. I was not criticizing. I didn't see because
okay.
I couldn't read.
Yeah.
So, I explain that. How I see as an economist, and I'm sure Astrid, I hope she will agree with me. So we have this demand for cars. This is demand for cars. This is quantity, number of cars. And this is price. So we have that the lower the price, the higher the demand of cars. So we have the marginal private cost of having a car, and we have the marginal social cost. As we can see, marginal social costs are higher than the private. And this distance, is the difference between, this is the externality, this difference. So when a person decides to have a car, to use a car, he only takes into account his marginal cost. But social costs are higher. So we have this equilibrium, we have a number of cars larger than the optimum. The optimum is here, right in this point. So the right optimum of cars is low. It is lower than we already have. But besides of that, I wanted to explain this because I think it's very, very illustrative. And this explains a little bit what an externality is. So imagine we have 10 people in the street, on the street, and they spend 8 minutes. They are I'm a driver, I'm a car driver, I'm right in front of the street, and I need to decide if I go to the street or not. So what I observe, that moment there are 10 people, there are 10 cars, and then they spend over 10 minutes. So we have this, I mean, this would be the overall time of the system. So I'm a car and I want to get into the system. So I will be the number 11 in the street, on the streets. But if I get into the road, that would mean that the time, every car that is in the, on the street will increase from 8 to 10 minutes. So in all the system, we will have 110 minutes instead of 80 minutes. So I am the driver. I'm only here. So we have an extra time in the system of 30 minutes. So I am the driver and I only observe 11, but the rest I'm not responsible for the rest of the extra time. So is it clear? Somehow?
So you're trying to say that it's...
What is an externality? Okay. You're trying to explain what an externality is.
Yes, yes, for instance. So what we have here is a network externality.
But the individual decision doesn't care about...
Exactly.
Yeah.
That was what you're trying to say, that everybody's taking individual decisions?
Absolutely.
And nobody's seeing the collective...
Yeah.
Exactly. That's a thing.
So,
but this is.
I'm a lawyer, so I don't.
But maybe this is quite clear.
But also, like, it's not only that they're not taking into account the others' decisions. That means every single person who adds their own individual decision, the overall effect gets larger and larger over time.
Exactly.
But not proportionally.
Wow. Yeah.
It is not proportionally, as you said. Yes. Yes. And the policies that we currently have, they even lower the cost drivers are facing. So what I'm saying in this is that we have the social cost, we have the private cost, but there are policies that move this line even lower to the right. So what we are facing, what drivers are facing, is a line here, over here, this direction. So the equilibrium is even more current because policies are designed in Mexico in that way.
Mm-hmm.
How do they do that? Because there are tax reductions. Drivers in Mexico, they pay taxes. Yes, they do. But only, I think, some for the... what is IVA? I mean
that. VAT.
VAT, exactly. VAT. But they do not annually pay a charge.
There is no annual driver car license fee.
There is a driver license.
No, but the tax is once when you buy the car.
There was, but it was just removed a few years ago.
Yes, it was removed. Exactly. So
you have to help,
but it's better for the industry, isn't it?
I mean, the role of the government is to help the car industry, isn't it?
Sure.
And it was a very popular measure. It was removed here 3 years ago, and after that, several states have been doing the same, and they get like, wow, thank you.
Well, of course.
This is a good government. This is a good government. So we have...
Any tax you got?
Huh?
Any tax you got, you make people happy.
Yeah.
Exactly. So people were very happy. Oh, yeah, this is a demonstration, but I will explain you why it is. So there are also some construction requirements, and every new construction must have at least a minimum parking space.
Mm-hmm.
So you are making parking more, less expensive. I think they will remove these construction requirements this year. I think so.
They will remove it.
Yes, because maximum amount of parking slots in new constructions. So it is a time when government build more elevated highways, more streets, they are reducing the time for commuting from point A to point B.
Temporary,
exactly. There used to be some subsidy for food, not anymore. And I must explain this picture is of this month. There are demonstrations because price of food increased. So you can see people on the streets.
We saw cops outside the gas station waiting so that no people would protest.
Yeah, I was talking to a taxi cab driver. He told me that the price is still really low. So when I made the conversion like to Colombia to US, gas in Mexico is like free. I think it should be with those costs, I'm sure it's subsidized still. They like get it up like 30%. That's what I heard in the news. But I don't know, but I feel like it's still subsidized and a lot.
Yeah. I don't know if it is still subsidized because taxes are about 30% of the price.
$2 a gallon.
Taxes
like that.
Are what, 30%
subsidized? It's just not taxed.
Which is nothing.
But $2, it's like $2 a gallon.
It's the same.
And I say that's not even the cost of extracting it from the soil. So.
Yeah.
It's cheap.
Petroleum.
That is insanely cheap.
Yeah.
It's really cheap. It's like Venezuela that they also.
Yeah.
We are an oil country.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
People believe that if we produce oil,
it's subsidized.
Yeah,
in the end, Pemex and Venezuela, what they do is that their earnings they give it to the people by giving low price gasoline.
The same in Iran, no?
Was and still, yeah. Because they are not that dynamic, so they remove the subsidies, so we reach to relatively the same price, but then the prices go up and then the inflation and everything, so now we are back again to almost half of the cost.
How much
to put
how
up.
Much the liter?
Now it's almost 25 cents per liter.
Well, but I think that here is a culture.
Right.
That's
but
what
for a while it was almost a dollar.
Yeah.
So.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness, almost a dollar.
No, I think those are interesting. I mean, those are interesting things. If you look at Turkey, it's $3 a liter. Okay.
And then people were, you know, how we call it, exporting illegally gasoline from Iran to Turkey.
So Turkey, of course. That's what
all the
and it's all taxes. I mean,
yeah.
300% taxes.
Well,
$3
from Venezuela and they're rich.
In Brazil, is $1.30, but 80% is tax.
Yeah,
80%.
Yes. Okay, go on.
Okay, so this is very important because I'm always a kind of piece of criticism. The enforcement of transit regulation. We have a new enforcement, we have a new transit regulation. I think it was this year or last year, I don't remember. December last year.
December 2015.
Yes. 1 year. We have a 1 year with a new transit regulation. But so far, I think enforcement is very low. So people can commit. I mean, the likelihood that a car driver get a fine or a ticket for not accomplishing the transit regulation is very low.
Mm-hmm.
So, what is my plan?
Okay, now.
My aim is making cities more sustainable, equity, not being carbon locking, and I want to avoid car dependency. In this topic, I must say that some of the what I've heard from authorities is because it is that they want to reorientate the car transportation. They want to change from a fuel car to electric cars. I don't think that's the answer. And it might help. I mean, I'm not opposing to that, but it's not you're not going to resolve or solve the problems. we have. Okay, so my aim is making utilities more sustainable and equity, as I said. With this orientation, environment, equity, and economy, doing transport systems, urban transport systems, more equitable, efficient, attractive, and convenient. I'm really confident, I really believe in this structure of being pedestrians on the top of the mobility. What else? I'm also interested in freight.
So the car is at the bottom, or what?
Yes, the cars are at the bottom.
Okay.
Bottom.
According to the law.
But this is the...
According to the law.
The traffic regulation, this is what it says, that pedestrian has the first priority, then the bike, but this is only in regulation.
But in
exactly.
The end, it's a decision of mobility. I want to go from point A to point B. Can I go walking? If it's 300 kilometers away, I'm sure you can't. Or
yeah,
maybe you are
bikes.
Like a Kenyan
this
guy who could do that.
Yeah, this
can I go walking? It's not far, but I get killed. You know, I cannot cross the street. I mean, I cannot,
it's,
you know, I mean.
Yeah.
So it's not only a question of distance. It's
well,
also,
of course.
I mean, there's no space for walking there.
Do you have a question?
Several.
Several?
No, my basic question. I'm not sure if I understand. So you said that your challenge is the traffic congestion in Mexico City.
Yeah.
Yes, I mean, mobility in general. I mean, I want to improve mobility. That
in Mexico
transport
City?
In the metropolitan area.
Of Mexico City?
Of Mexico City.
Okay. Because then I'm not sure if I understand why now you talk about cities in general.
Ah, because I would like to be a consulting.
Yeah.
So I can start with Mexico City, but I can work everywhere.
Okay, so what we're discussing is your life plan, or
that's a very important point. Because
no,
you have a concept, but now you have to make a problem out of that.
Mohammed told me to explain that.
No, that's
I'm
good,
sorry.
And that's the thing. You know, you have a concern, and now you have to make a problem out of that, which we can work on that. And this is the whole process that
but
you have to do now.
That's what you told me, though. It's not that I'm promoting myself. It's just Mohammed told me.
That's great.
You want to become an expert that people hire when they want to transform the city to become more, I don't know, equitable, efficient, attractive, and something like this. That's okay. So
is that a problem or
in transport?
Matthias, you have a problem with that?
Challenge. I don't have problems. I'm challenging. No. I just try to understand what we're looking at here.
Yeah.
Exactly.
No, there are more. How you wanted to do this?
Let's keep going.
Yeah. Go ahead.
So here, okay. I think you cannot read this.
Okay. In her plan.
But these are the policies I want to apply to this challenge.
Mm-hmm.
There are three axes. The first one is
local policies for Mexico.
Yeah, Mexico.
Yeah. Now I'm talking for
okay.
For Mexico City. This is my action plan.
Yeah.
For Mexico, metropolitan area of Mexico City.
Good.
There are three axes, as I said, the regulatory framework.
Mm-hmm.
So, how to regulate, how public provided services and privately provided services. So, what respects to privately provided, how the bidding process works. How to make the right design, this is very important, the incentives for these concessions. In the case of publicly provided services, can also be right design and incentives.
Mm-hmm.
So, and the idea is that they collaborate with each other, so they work as a network.
Mm-hmm.
There are some pull and push policies. What I mean with pull and push policies are taxes and subsidies. Taxes for cars. I mean, for instance, congestion charges for cars, fuel prices, and parking prices. So we can push drivers into public transportation. But at the same time, we need to offer them good public transportation. So I want to change the resources from this side to this side. I mean, from public transport, from cars to public transportation.
Mm-hmm. Quick question, how does the congestion charge work?
this is in an area. I mean, some cities use that.
London.
We don't. What?
London.
So
you are charged once you enter a certain area.
Yeah, there are many policies. This is one
you can even have dynamic charges. You know, when the road, California, when the road gets very congested, you actually pay more for using the road than when it's less congested.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
nice.
That's smart.
Negative prices? No.
No, not negative.
Okay.
You know, the taller you have a flat.
That's smart. Expensive. That's a smart city.
Except
charges more.
Or they have on the highway between San Francisco and Los Angeles, you have different lanes, and each lane has a different price. You know, so the ones you want to overtake, you know, you go on the faster lane, you pay more than if you are on the slower lane.
Or you pay more if you're only one person in the car.
Absolutely.
Yes, like in a
traffic.
There are many policies. This is just one example. Plenty of policies for doing
exactly
this.
or if you are more than two people in the car, you can
use
that
lane
and you cannot
use
the other and the other ones cannot use it. So
Brenda, what is the difference of the colors here? Does it make sense?
Yeah.
Just some other old design.
Okay. Because I understand that
that's part of her life plan. It's a colorful life plan.
But my understanding was that some of them are your concerns, which you want us
to
focus on.
No, it's just
like
that. It would
be.
Okay, so that's
a less gray, more colorful.
Yeah, green, two grays, a little green.
So, I want to design policies for push and pull. I mean, pushing drivers to public transportation and pulling, I'm pulling them into the public transportation. And so you have, you need to offer them good public transportation. I know that. You cannot only increase prices without providing efficient transport. So, and this is kind of new. I'm still learning this part. The part of modeling, the relationship between public transport and car transport. So how, for instance, how people decide which mode to use, why people decide which mode to use, subway, BRT, how do they decide the best path from point A to point B, demand estimation, how demand is affected by an increasing price, for instance. I want to see the network effects, how all these work together. For instance, in the BRT project that we saw, what I think was missing was the relationship with the rest of the system, of the transport system. There was no fitting strategies, they do not assess the subway, how the BRT will be connected to the subway. So that's what I want to do also. And I want to make some scenarios.
What is it? Elaboration?
The scenarios, because there are many variables.
The third part of the plan is what? I didn't get it.
The
first
one
framework?
Is modeling. I mean, it's like, how do you, this modeling part helps in the investment design. Once you know how the system works, you can decide how to allocate resources. If you are going to build a BRT, if you are going to build that.
So this is like
subway.
A transportation study, you mean?
Yes.
So on which part do you want us to help you? Because for all of that, we cannot do that in 2 weeks. And I think, you know, looking at your diagram, the very wide side, that's too technical, so I'm not sure if that would be the most relevant topic for the action research. And then I let you choose between, you want us to focus on the fiscal incentives or on the regulation and competition policy part. Which one you want, and then we narrow it down to make it a little bit
more
concrete.
I think
that's it.
People are going to propose some concrete stuff, so we cannot propose 200 strategies.
No, in my view, they are linked. You know, the regulation and the fiscal are linked.
Yeah, they are.
In my view, this is not. I mean, but this is your
way.
Yes,
I mean, I thought that as well. I mean, there are some related. I think the three are related, actually, somehow.
The right one, you can separate the links.
Yeah, let me just clarify that. You
okay.
you have you explained that a challenge in the city. And then you have your personal approach, how you want to address it. The better you clarify to us that how we can help you, the better we can help you as well.
Yeah.
If you tell us very broadly and you are not clear on your approach as the first, second, third step, then that would be difficult for us. So can you give us a little bit of more illustration? How can, in these 2 weeks, we can help you to just resolve part of that, not the whole puzzle?
Yeah.
That's why I think it's very important what Matthias said, the question, because the problem is congestion. The problem you want to resolve is congestion. It's a different approach than if it's a mobility,
inequity,
mobility, resource.
Exactly.
It's like, it's,
then,
different.
The,
it's a different plan and a different
absolutely
approach.
The process really starts here, you know. We heard about, you know, Brenda's presentation, so now she might have some ideas, or this is something that happens often when you go to give a little bit of consultancy. You go and then they tell, we have a problem in Mexico City. And then, okay, so what can I do for you exactly? And they don't know what they want from you. So that's part of the process, to formulate a doable project that can help her, but we can also help. That's a collective process.
Mm-hmm.
So you can advise us a little bit, but we don't expect you to tell us exactly what you need. That's part of our own responsibility as well, to help you frame that. So give us a little bit of input, and then we discuss and try to come up with a problem.
I think that we do it, two parts. I mean, one is this and the fiscal incentives. This, I mean, I think this are not that easy to for you to do in this part. I don't think it's will be very easy. And in this part, I think we need data for me.
So I
think this part and this part, incentives could be. This could be an easy task or relatively easy. And taxes and subsidies, but this part, bidding process, this is, I mean, very demanding, I mean, technical, and you need the data for that. So,
but you know, taxes and subsidies are incentives.
Yes, I know.
So incentives, you mean incentives for people to use public transportation?
Yeah.
Or
yes.
Not to use, or disincentives to use the car.
Okay.
I think that the car is the center of the discussion. It's more than mobility.
Yeah.
For sure.
Car congestion.
After, in the end,
so it's different.
We are talking about mobility, but the framework that you've shown is the car is a culture,
it's a problem.
Mexican,
it's a
problem. Way of life, also.
It is.
The oil prices must be low because people think as Mexico produces oil, it must be as cheap as possible. So I think that your main goal is how to disencourage people to use car and go to the other side.
Yes, incentives.
So,
and in my view, this is not the Mexican problem. I think this is generalizable. If you say, how can we reduce car usage or cars? And that's a problem of every city. I mean, that's the goal of the Swiss government,
car
is party. To have less cars in the country. Okay?
Back to the beginning of your somewhere at the beginning of your presentation, you said that when you were looking at the ways that you wanted to get to work,
not that,
or whatever, like it doesn't matter. But when you were looking at the way